Welcome back to our lecture series on nanostructured materials, science and technology. I am Professor Ashutosh Tiwari from the Department of Material Science and Engineering at the University of Utah. In the last lecture, we explored scaling laws in fluids and biology, seeing how pressure-driven flow fails at the nanoscale, and how scaling principles govern blood flow, metabolism, and even lifespan. We concluded that scaling is powerful but limited. At very small scales, classical predictions break down. Today, in lecture 6, we begin with the quantum foundations of nanotechnology. We will ask, why do we need quantum mechanics, and explore how it reshaped physics at the dawn of the 20th century. Newton's mechanics described planets and machines. Maxwell's equation unified electricity, magnetism, and light. Thermodynamics explained heat engines and energy conservation. By the late 1800s, many believed physics was complete. Lord Kelvin even remarked in 1900 that only two small clouds remained. But cracks soon emerged. Experiments showed that energy did not vary smoothly but in discrete jumps. Atoms revealed sharp spectral lines instead of continuous rainbows. Light sometimes behaved as a wave, sometimes as a particle. Classical physics could no longer explain nature fully. One major puzzle was blackbody radiation. Classical theory predicted infinite energy at short wavelengths, the so-called ultraviolet catastrophe. But experiments showed that radiation peaked and then dropped at high frequencies. It was here that Max Planck made his bold proposal, energy is quantized. Planck told, energy is not continuous but comes in discrete packets or quanta. Energy of each packet is proportional to frequency, with Planck's constant as proportionality factor. This was revolutionary. Instead of smooth waves of energy, nature works in steps. Though Planck himself considered it a mathematical trick, his hypothesis became the seed of quantum mechanics. Without it, Einstein's photon theory and the rest of the quantum physics would never have followed. Think about money. You can't pay with 0.083 cents. Only whole coins or bills are allowed. Nature works the same way. Energy does not flow smoothly in arbitrary amounts. It comes in indivisible chunks or quanta. Just as the smallest coin sets the unit of currency, Planck's constant sets the size of these energy packets. This everyday analogy gives us a way to understand something radical. The universe itself is quantized at its most fundamental level. Einstein took Planck's bold idea further. He proposed that light itself is made of particles, photons, each carrying energy. In the photoelectric effect, when light shines on a metal, electrons are ejected. Classical wave theory could not explain this. Why weak light of high frequency can eject electrons instantly, while intense low frequency light cannot? Einstein's photon model explained three puzzling facts that classical wave theory could not. First, there is a threshold frequency. If light is below this frequency, no matter how intense, it cannot eject electrons because each photon lacks the minimum energy. Five. Second, increasing intensity at a frequency above threshold does not change the maximum energy of the electron. It only increases the number of photons and therefore the number of electrons ejected. Third, emission is instantaneous. Electrons appear the moment light of sufficient frequency shines, with no measurable delay. This is only possible if energy transfer happens in discrete photon-electron collisions. Another experimental observation that used to puzzle the scientists was the strange emission spectrum of hydrogen. When they studied hydrogen's emission spectrum, they expected a continuous rainbow of colors as classical theory predicted. Instead, they found a set of sharp, discrete lines. This discovery suggested that electrons inside atoms could not take arbitrary energies, but only specific quantized levels. Each spectral line corresponded to an electron falling from a higher level to a lower one, emitting light of a precise frequency. Hydrogen's discrete spectrum was one of the strongest pieces of evidence against classical physics, pointing directly towards quantum theory. To solve above mystery, Bohr proposed a revolutionary picture of the atom. electrons circle the nucleus in stable quantized orbits without radiating energy. This solved a huge puzzle of classical physics, why atoms don't collapse as electrons spiral inward. When an electron jumps from one orbit to another, the energy difference is released or absorbed as a photon, explaining the sharp spectral lines of hydrogen. This was a triumph for early quantum theory. It captured hydrogen's behavior beautifully. However, Bohr's model could not handle more complex atoms or account for fine details. It was a stepping stone pointing toward the full quantum mechanics that come later. After Bohr's model of quantized orbits, a deeper explanation was needed. Why do only certain orbits exist? Louis de Broglie proposed a radical idea. Matter itself has wave-like properties. The wavelength of a particle is given by lambda equal to h by p, where h is the Planck's constant and p is the momentum. For macroscopic objects like a baseball, the momentum is so large that the wavelength is unimaginably small, far beyond detection. But for tiny particles such as electrons, the wavelength becomes significant, and experiments show that electrons can diffract and interfere just like light waves. This idea explained Bohr's quantized orbits naturally. Electrons can only exist in orbits where their matter waves fits around the nucleus like a standing wave. De Broglie's hypothesis was bold, but could matter waves actually be observed? Yes, in 1927, Davison and Germer directed a beam of electrons at a crystal and saw diffraction patterns, just like X-rays or light waves. This was the experimental proof that electrons, which we normally think of as particles, behave like waves at small scales. The observed diffraction angles matched perfectly with de Broglie's wavelength formula, which is lambda equal to h by p. Electron diffraction confirmed that matter waves are real, turning de Broglie's hypothesis into a cornerstone of quantum mechanics. From the last experiment, we saw that electrons, once thought of as particles, can also behave like waves. Light takes this idea even further. Sometimes it behaves like a wave, spreading out and interfering, as in double-slit experiment. At other times, it behaves like a particle, with individual photons transferring energy in collisions, as we saw in the photoelectric effect. This wave-particle duality is not a contradiction, but rather a complementary description. Light is both a wave and a particle, depending on how we look at it. This dual nature lies at the very heart of quantum mechanics. To build more confidence in the idea of dual nature, let us look at one of the most famous experiments in physics, the double-slit experiment. This setup is deceptively simple. A source aimed at a barrier with two narrow slits and a detector screen placed behind it. First, imagine firing bullets. As expected, they behave like particles, leaving two sharp bands on the screen directly behind the slits. Next, think of waves like water or light. The waves pass through both slits, overlap and interfere. This produces a series of bright and dark bands on an interference pattern across the detector. Finally, replace the bullets or waves with electrons, actual particles of matter. Surprisingly, even when electrons are sent one at a time, the pattern that emerges is not two simple bands, but an interference pattern, just like waves. This experiment is often called physics' most beautiful demonstration because it vividly shows that matter, like light, can behave both as particles and as waves. Now, we will look into each of these experiments in more detail. Let us first imagine firing actual bullets at a barrier with two openings. Each bullet is a classical particle. It either goes through the left slit or the right slit. On the screen behind, we simply see two clusters of hits, one behind each slit. There is no interference, no overlapping patterns, just two distinct peaks, exactly what we expect from classical particles. Now consider experiments with a wave. When we send waves through two slits, whether water waves or light waves, something remarkable happens. Each slit becomes a new source of waves that spread out in circular ripples. Where the ripples overlap, they interfere, sometimes reinforcing each other to make bright regions and sometimes canceling to make a dark regions. On the screen, this interference shows up as a series of bright and dark stripes, not just two peaks. This is the hallmark of wave behavior, the ability to superpose and interfere. It is the very phenomena that made scientists realize that light itself must behave as a wave. In the previous slide, we saw how bullets give two bands and waves create an interference pattern. Now let us focus on electrons. Fired one at a time, each arrival looks like a particle, but as the hits accumulate, a wave-like interference pattern emerges. Crucially, if we close either slit, the interference vanishes. The distribution collapses to a single broad band with no fringes, because the electrons no longer have two paths to interfere with itself. This is the hallmark of wave-particle duality. Electrons can look particle-like in detection, yet reveal their wave nature when both slits are open. Here is what the experiment teaches us. Each electron lands as a single dot, particle-like, yet the overall stripe pattern appears only when the two possible paths interfere like waves. Interference needs two open, indistinguishable slits. Close one or find out which slit it used and the fringes vanish, because we stop adding wave amplitudes and start adding ordinary probabilities. That is the measurement effect. Which path information destroys the phase relation. So electrons and matter in general are not simply particles or waves, they obey quantum rules. Let us bring the key ideas together. In 1900, Max Planck introduced the quantum hypothesis, showing that energy comes in discrete packets called quanta. In 1905, Albert Einstein explained the photoelectric effect, proving that light behaves as particles we now call photons. In 1913, Niels Bohr proposed quantized orbits for electrons, explaining the line spectra of hydrogen. In 1924, Louis de Broglie extended the concept of duality to matter itself, suggesting that electrons and photons have wave-like properties. In 1927, Clinton Davison and Lester Germer confirmed this by observing electron diffraction, direct proof that matter behaves like waves. And in 1961, Klaus Johnson performed a double-slit experiment with electrons, once thought impossible. His doctoral work revealed clear electron interference patterns, a powerful demonstration of wave-particle duality. Decades later, in 2002, physicists voted this experiment the most beautiful experiment in physics. Together, these discoveries forced physics to move beyond classical certainty into a new world defined by quantum probability. We have now seen why classical physics was not enough and how the great scientists built the foundation of quantum mechanics. In our next lecture, we will begin to learn the language of quantum theory itself. We will introduce wave functions, explore uncertainty principle, and see how Schrödinger's equation provides the mathematical backbone of quantum mechanics. This is where quantum ideas move from experiments to equations.